Board illustrator who is a self-proclaimed Twilight Zone fanatic. He has written and designed the book Visions from the Twilight Zone, and welcome to Night Watch. Why are you interested in the Twilight Zone? Everybody has their own story. How'd you start?
I think the hanging eyeball in outer space from that opening you just saw, I saw that when I was 5 years old in 1963, and I just think that image burned itself into my brain, and I always just remembered the Twilight Zone and those the shock endings, the show itself. I just never forgot it.
What was the impression you got from the first few episodes? Did you buy into it completely as a child watching it?
Well, totally. I mean, the show was the dimension of imagination, and I think the Twilight Zone stimulated my imagination and caused me to become an artist probably more than any other influence.
How would you describe it as a show? A lot of people haven't seen it, probably. I mean, it is a bit of television history.
At this point, I'm describing these half-hour Twilight Zone episodes as sort of like the hit singles of television. They're not like albums, but just like a hit single, a three-minute song has a great hook. There's something about these Twilight Zone episodes, their structure. The opening tease gets you entranced. There's a half-hour break, which leaves you hanging. And then there's that final shock ending, which just, you can't forget it. They're unforgettable. And those are the things about those episodes, the quality. All across the board, the acting, the writing, the directing. It reads like a who's who of Hollywood. Mm.
It's science fiction to some extent, it's horror to some extent. Is there some way to sum it all up in one
word? I like to describe the Twilight Zone as surrealism on television. I think of all of those elements, it had elements of science fiction, it had elements of horror and fantasy, but I think when I really investigated the show and did my research into surrealism, I realized that the Twilight Zone at its core was surrealism on television in the sense that the early surrealists in the 20th century wanted people to look at their world, look at themselves, their reality, look at it fresh, step back from it. And that, I think, of all of the things about the Twilight Zone, that is at the heart of it, and that's what I think struck people and remained to them to this day. When people hum the Twilight Zone theme song, when they something happens to them and all of a sudden somebody goes doo 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 doo, what they're really doing is acknowledging a moment of surrealist experience in which they've come up to their reality and are forced to step back from it. And that's really what the Twilight Zone was about, and that's what I tried to hone in on in my book.
Let's get a feeling for it, because it's one thing to talk about it, it's another thing to look at it. We have a clip from Nightmare at 20,000 Feet, which stars William Shatner, who went on to greater fame.
Star Trek.
And he's on an airplane, and he sees something out the window. Let's take a look at this clip.
Honey, would you wake up, honey?
Yes, Mr. Wilson? Can I help you, Mr. Wilson?
Are we going into a storm?
Just a small one, nothing to worry about.
There's always a kind of paranoia in these episodes. Do you think Serling himself was a bit paranoid as a person?
I don't think so. Then again, I really wouldn't know for sure, but it's interesting about that episode. One of the things that Serling locked in on was what I call suburban nightmares, things in average American settings that force you again to jolt out of the ordinary and look at them fresh. I mean, I think we've all been in a situation like that, whether on a train or a plane or a car, where you go to look out the window and something is there. And it's things like that that he was able to hone in on.
But what he did in this particular episode was the twist at the end. It really was there.
Right. And I've juxtaposed an image of William Shatner, that close-up when he's shocked, with a line of dialogue from another episode that says, "The human imagination is often weird. Sometimes it means salvation." Because he was the only one on that plane that saw that gremlin on the wing, and yet because he saw it, he was able to save the airplane from destruction, and yet everybody else thought he was crazy.
And he ends up getting carted away.
Exactly. But yet, it was imagination that caused the salvation. of the airplane.
What made you want to do a book? I mean, people think of The Twilight Zone as a television show that sometimes you can see it once or twice a year if you're lucky, or it's on reruns on some UHF channel.
Right.
But why do it in a book?
I've always felt that The Twilight Zone didn't look like any other television show, and I couldn't put my finger on what it was about that look. You could be flipping around the dial, and there's something about you know when you landed on Twilight Zone. And in the late 70s, when video artists first started to photograph images off a TV set and present them as art objects, I thought, well, I should do that with Twilight Zone one day. And I procrastinated a few years. When I finally got around to doing it, I realized that what I had was a coffee table art book about the show that treated the images like black and white art photography. And the fact that these are images that, while they were shown on television, still qualifies beautiful black and white images.
Is that what you think makes this show different, stand out?
That's one of the things. I think that the director of photography, the directors, they knew they were designing shows for television. And I mean, we talk about television as the medium for the close-up and the talking head. Well, I think of all television shows, The Twilight Zone has the most arresting visual images, the greatest close-ups, the greatest graphic objects, the most striking photography. And so the book, Visions from the Twilight Zone, I tried to get the best television images, but then I also tried to get the best philosophical visions, the best words, the lines of dialogue and narration that really put a finger on what The Twilight Zone was really about. And then I just juxtaposed the two. When I had the great images and the great words, if lines of dialogue from one episode illustrated an image from another episode, I put those two together. And I just tried to create like an art book portrait of what the show was really about.
We've got a chance to look a little bit more at what the show is really about in a moment, because we've got more clips from The Twilight Zone and more conversation when Night Watch continues. We're back with Arlen Shumer, who's written possibly the ultimate groupie book for Twilight Zone fans, Visions from The Twilight Zone. And it is that vision of The Twilight Zone that sticks with people, I think. It's that image. It's never just the dialogue. When you say the words, it's always some image that comes right to you. Don't you think so?
I think so. And, you know, on the one hand, while I think it is the ultimate fan book, I'd also like to think that I tried to be very generic and very universal in choosing images and the lines of dialogue. I did not want this to be a book in which you had to be a Twilight Zone fan to understand the book. Mm. Because in my opinion, there really are no hardcore Twilight Zone fans, because the show did not have continuing characters. It didn't build up all this trivia that you associate with most of these classic old television shows.
Like Star Trek.
Star Trek, Mary Tyler Moore, The Honeymoon. With continuing characters, you can build up all of this inside hardcore fan knowledge. Mm. The only thing about The Twilight Zone is the concept itself, and Rod Serling should be considered the only real star. So for that reason, for instance, the images of the actors and actresses, I did not make this a book of portraits of Hollywood stars, even though practically every Hollywood star was in it. I only chose portraits in which the characters were acting out the Twilight Zone look, whatever that might be. But the images and also the words, I just tried to be very universal so that when somebody looks at it, they shouldn't have to be a Twilight Zone fan to know what I'm trying to get across.
You recreate in this book one entire episode, which is Beauty is in the Eye of the Beholder. And we have a clip from that, which is the very end of the television program. This woman has spent most of her life in hospitals, all bandaged up. When you first see her, she's bandaged. You don't see the faces of anyone who's treating her, but it's clear from watching this that she's deformed. She has a deformity.
She's gone through 11 operations.
They're trying to fix her. And in the very end, she meets someone else who is also deformed, and we see her face. Let's take a look.
Why do we have to look like this?
There's an old saying, beauty is in the eye of the beholder. Come on now. We'll get your things and we'll leave.
Now the questions that come to mind. Where is this place and when is it? What kind of world where ugliness is the norm and beauty the deviation from that norm? You want an answer? The answer is, it doesn't make any difference. Because the old saying happens to be true. Beauty is in the eye of the beholder. In this year or 100 years hence, on this planet or wherever there is human life, perhaps out amongst the stars, beauty is in the eye of the beholder. Lesson to be learned in the Twilight Zone.
Why'd you choose that episode in particular to do the whole storyboard?
Well, on the one hand, conceptually, it's right up Rod Serling's alley. This was his main theme, the individual against the state, the individual against conformity. So it's the perfect Rod Serling script. It's also got, I think, of all the Twilight Zone surprise endings, the most unforgettable surprise ending. But then, knowing that I wanted to show every single image from the show, I had to pick an episode that could stand up to that kind of treatment. And because the director could not show the doctors or nurses' faces throughout the episode, it's directed and choreographed almost like a performance piece, like a ballet. And the compositions are very stylized. So it was able to stand up to that microscopic treatment. But beyond that, I think that the episode is also the theme of the book, that I felt that The Twilight Zone was a beautiful show, that television images deserve to be treated like art images. So therefore, Visions from the Twilight Zone, it is beauty in the eye of the beholder.
Was this show a hit at the time?
No, The Twilight Zone, contrary to what most people believe, it was not a ratings success. It had a round robin of sponsors. The Twilight Zone was the sort of intellectual prestige show of CBS of that day. And even at one point, just like Star Trek and some of these other great shows that didn't get high ratings, it was canceled for a time and then brought back as an hour-long series, failed again, and then finally was canceled. But at one point, they knew that they had a loyal following of young people, and one of the Twilight Zone authors said, maybe it's because that adults are inclined to fear the imagination, while children and young people are inclined to let loose the full play of it.
Do you think it would have worked in color, and is the advance of color in television what killed it eventually?
Well, at one point early in its production, there was pressure on Serling to turn the show into a color show, and George T. Clemens, the director of photography, objected vehemently. He said, we can't give you what we feel is the Twilight Zone feeling in color like we could in black and white. And that's the thing about the Twilight Zone. The very name is the middle ground between light and shadow. It's a black and white concept. And I think television, when it first started, was a small black and white box. I mean, the full color, technicolor, that's for the movies in which they're trying to recreate reality. You want people to step into the screen. The Twilight Zone was a small black and white box, and black and white works perfect for television. And I'm just surprised that the powers that be in Hollywood don't feel that a black and white show would be successful again. And yet, every creative music video, every artistic TV commercial seems to be done in black and white.
We only have a little bit of time. We haven't really looked at Rod himself, and let's do that in the opening to The Living
Yes.
Doll.
My name is Talkie Tina, and I don't think I like you.
Talkie Tina, a doll that does everything. A lifelike creation of plastic and springs and painted smile. To Eric Strater, she is a most unwelcome addition to his household. But without her, he'd never enter Twilight Zone.
That voice, we've all heard it. How important was his presence to this show?
Well, I think Rod Serling was one of the three coolest guys of the early 60s. His command of the camera, he thought he was nervous and not good for the camera, but yet he's one of the greatest television icons. I think at the same time, with John F. Kennedy, and maybe he even predated Sean Connery as a great early 60s media figure. And it was his presence, because he was the creator of the show, that lent this great host quality to it.
He really, it's sad that he's no longer around doing stuff. In 10 seconds, what do you think he'd be doing today if he were still alive?
I think he would be writing. He considered himself above and beyond. I think he wanted his epitaph to be that he was a writer. Mm-hmm. And I think in the end, I think he touched more people's imaginations with great ideas than at least any television writer of our time.
Arlen Schumer, thanks for coming in to
Thank
talk
you.
With us on Night Watch. We'll be back in just a moment. Stay with us.